Thank you for the great introductions. So today, let me tell you, like in our lab, we found that ear is actually the very special body part. Not only capture any kind of biosignal, we also find out that ear actually can use to measure the blood pressures. And when you come to the hospital, the first vital sign that people measure is actually blood pressures, because this is one of the key vital signals to identify many serious diseases. This is show some of them. One is hypertension, heart failure, or even the kidney failure. There are many devices used to measure the blood pressure at home. It could be like arm cup blood pressure monitoring, wrist cup blood pressure monitoring. Those are great to measure a few times a day. However, let's consider the patient who are hypertension, and they need to diagnose the disease in the hospital and at home as well. So they have to wear the similar device for 24 hours. And you take the measurement for about 10 to 15 minutes one time, and this is highly uncomfortable, inconvenient, and it limits all of their daily activities. Motivated on that, we introduce a new modalities of measuring blood pressures, which is from inside the ear. And this is convenient, this is unobtrusive, because all the components can hide behind the ear, and this can use as a frequent and long-term uses. Let's see how can we do this. So one of the key insights is by looking at the arterial system around the ear. There is one superficial close to the ear. From here, there is a superficial temporal artery. And also from the side behind the ear, there is a posterior articular artery. That they are the two potential arteries that we can capture the blood pressures from inside the ear. In order to do so, we would like to, based on the existing technique of the cuff bay device. So as you can see inside here is the closed loop of the wrist blood pressure monitoring. And this is the area that it can create a pressure to compress the artery. And based on this information, it can capture the systolic and diastolic blood pressures. We want to actually apply the same idea into our system, but unfortunately, it is impossible because the ear canal architecture is actually totally different with the arm and the wrist body part. Therefore, we introduce a new way. We use a small balloon attached with a pulse sensor and plug into the inside the ear. So when the balloon is bent, it will create a force, similar force, and press again one side of the artery inside the ear. Also, as we attempt to use the small balloon inside the ear, there's one issue that the balloon is very small and the air volume inside the balloon is not as much as the pressure of the cuff-based device. Therefore, it is not sensitive enough to capture the pulse waveform based on the change of the air pressures. On that reason, we integrate another sensor, which is called photoplethysmography or PPG sensor, which basically actually just a light-based sensor. It can capture the changing of the artery volume based on the variation of the intensity. Building such a device faces many challenges. And one of them is the arteries inside the ear cannot be completely blocked by the balloon. So what does it mean? We have to look at the cuff-based device. So when we inflate the cuff, it expands in all directions so that it can compress or block the artery. In our case, even we inflate the balloon, it can only press to one side of the artery. So this fundamental difference between two designs poses a very high challenge, which means we cannot apply any of the existing model for the blood pressure monitoring into our in-ear monitoring system. And therefore, one of the model is called oscillometric blood pressure measurement. So basically, in this model, people pump the pressure into the maximum, and then to block the artery, and then release the pressure inside the cuff. During this procedure, they can capture the pulse amplitude, and then based on this information, they detect all the variable used to calculate the systolic and diastolic blood pressures. In our case, it's different because we can only press to one side of the ear, and also it cannot totally block the ear, the inner ear artery. And also, if we pump it too much, it will cause the pain to do it differently. We have to improvise the existing method. Instead of pumping it up into the highest pressure level, we just slowly pump it until we find in the pulse amplitude, which indicate that we just pass the mean arterial pressure variable in our model. And also, instead of like the traditional method, they apply the fixed ratio. In our case, the diastolic blood pressure happened at the point that the pulse amplitude decrease strongest. So this is very important key information. Based on this, we just need to take the gradient of the pulse amplitude and find the minimum one, then we can allocate the diastolic blood pressures. Finding the systolic blood pressure is more challenging because since the balloon doesn't cover the area of systolic blood pressures, there's no information about it. So how we can find this? We have to recall one of the key equations. This is called the relational equation between the mean arterial pressures and systolic and diastolic blood pressures. So this is the short summary that how can we derive the equation. Suppose this is the pulse waveform, and the MAP is actually just the average value of all the pressure in the pulse cycle. And assuming that if the pulse duration is from 0 to tau, beta is actually the systolic fraction. Just this is the ratio between the systolic time durations over the cycle time duration. Then we can break the above equation into two pieces. The first one is the pressure in the systolic phase, and the second one is the pressure in the diastolic phase. And you can see the one inside the bracket is actually the average value of all the pressure in the systolic phase, and is corresponding to the systolic blood pressure. Similarly, we have the diastolic blood pressures. This is a simplified version of our equation, and beta is actually the variable that we can estimate from the pulse shape given by this formula. So in the equation, we have beta, we have the diastolic blood pressure, which is PD, and the MAP pressure, PM. Then we can substitute all the variable and calculate the systolic blood pressures. Previously is the challenge of the model. We also face another challenge with finding and making the balloon that can put inside the ear as well. So the balloon needs to be medical safe, biocompatible, and it should be comfortable with the users because they will put inside the ear. And one of the key is we should be able to put the BPG sensor on top of the balloon, and it should be inside the ear as well, even when it's in flight. Should be stable inside the ear. So how we make the balloon? Usually any kind of medical balloon have one issue. It expands in all directions. And if we place the PPG sensor on top of the balloon, when it in flat and deflat, it will break the connection between the two components. And the sensor may stick into the user ear, and this is the terrible problem, right? So in order to fix this, we put a thin liquid silicone gel on top of one face of the balloon, place the sensor on the top. The thing is, we bake it for 1 hour at 80 Celsius degree. After it cooled down, the pulse sensor will stay firmly on the surface of the balloon. And the good news is that surface will be flat all the way. So this is how our prototype looks like. We also use the flexible circuit to increase the flexibility and reduce the size of the sensor when we play inside the ear. So we also care about the usability. We put a soft silicone layer on top of the sensor to cover all the sharp edge so it won't harm the user inside the ear. So this is the figure show that the balloon inflate, and as you can see now, it can only inflate to one side, the other side completely flat. This is how we build our prototype for the circuit. So it includes all the components, the sonic bell, the pressure sensors, and some of ESD protection to increase, to protect the circuit. And we also include the driver for the PPC sensor as well. And when we plug all the components into one, and this is how our user wear. So in the experiment, we test on different number of users with different variable of blood pressures. We use a ground truth device that is approved by the FDA. This is the Conquest. And because the pressure of artery inside the ear is kind of a little bit different with the arm and wrist, so we do the calibration by cross validates from data from the five subjects, and this is just the simple polynomial regression. So in the result, we show the difference between our system and the ground truth. We just subtract the two values. And for the systolic blood pressure, the mean error is about 1.8, and diastolic blood pressure is about minus 3.1. So according to the American standard for medical instrument, if the mean error is less than 5 millimeter in mercury, then the device is considered to be good. And also, the standard deviation should be less than 8 millimeter in mercury, and this is our device can certify. So with our system, we can integrate it into the earphone or any hearing aid in the future for frequently measuring blood pressure. Moreover, with the new way of pumping the pressure, we can apply into to improve the existing blood pressure monitoring device so that it can be more comfortable. Thank you for your attention.